today's secret sport isn't strictly a secret. I mean, how secret can a sport really be if it's got a beloved Australian film made about it after all? But it has been a little while since Strictly Ballroom. So you might be forgiven for thinking that these days a lot of the dance competitions going on are the ones featuring celebrities on the television. But that is not where DanceSport begins and ends. And it is our secret sport of Canberra for this week. A very big welcome to Vaughan Liddicoat. He's with us in the studio. He is the principal of the International Dance Studio here in Canberra. He's also a four-time Australian professional representative with his wife, Alison, who is at home with your new baby. Congratulations and welcome, Vaughan.
Oh, thank you. It's so lovely to be here.
It's a delight to have you here, I have to say. Be honest, are you sick of the Strictly Ballroom references? I can take it.
I'm not too. I think it did a wonderful thing for the ballroom dancing community at large because it brought it into the light. And so many people come in and saw, I remember seeing it when I was growing up, and now I'm going to try to attempt to dance and let's go into it. And it sort of sticks in people's heart. It's actually quite an amazing film from an Australian perspective.
I totally agree. So you're finding that that's still inspiring new generations
Absolutely.
Of ballroom dancers even today?
Yeah, that all the Strictly, the dance by, what is it, Patrick Swayze?
Dirty Dancing.
Dirty Dancing, jump, run and jump at me. You know? we'll do that in the second lesson.
Oh gosh, I wouldn't inflict that on anyone, I have to say. Apart from what we know that Baz Luhrmann is prone to exaggeration. That's part of the appeal. So if we've watched the film, does that actually give us an idea or an indication of what the competitive ballroom dance world is like, or is it maybe not your world?
That's a very good question, because there are essentially two worlds. I call them planets, right? There's the social ballroom planet, and then you've got the dance ball planet. And that's where the sort of serious people go, the people who become elite athletes and really want to do something with it and push the boundaries of what it is to dance. And most people don't realize they can actually do that. So when I first started dancing, I walked into a dance studio, very, very nervous, took my first steps, and then realized, this is actually really fun. Maybe this could be a fun pastime or hobby. And my coach came up to me, or became my coach, Penny DeCow. She's a beautiful lady, just passed away. She came up to me and took my hand, took Alison's hand and said, Vaughan, would you like to do dance sport? And I'm like, you can compete in this? And she's like, yes. And at the time I was in the development squad for rugby, AFL. And I was like, this two different worlds, right?
So very different worlds.
Let's go into that. That sounds like a fun thing to try. Why not? Can I do it with her? I'm in.
So obviously Alison would go on to become your wife. Was that the one of the significant pull factors away from AFL and into dance sport?
Gonna lie, it was. I think going to an all boys school, you look for creative outlets to try to meet other ladies, and that was one of them. But then it really quickly turned into an obsession and a passion. I really believe people need to be passionate about what they do in life and find some outlet like that, even if they're not good at it. You just start. I definitely had the two left feet. My coach called me a donkey, said, but we can fix that. And that was the thing. So then having Alison beside me, it did start off, you know, I'm gonna marry this woman. In fact, it had all the emotional roller coasters of a movie, right? You know, like you hate each other, you love each other, and going through that up and down. But that journey of dancing together and then ultimately going to London and moving and really getting up into the top 20 in the world for dancing in that sense was an incredible journey, and one that I just highly recommend people do. And I'm glad it's here, because most people don't realize they can do so much with dancing.
So before we get a bit into that story, because it's a great story, tell us, what is dance sport logistically? So when you're competing, what does that competition actually look like?
That's a great question. So when we look at dance sport, it's essentially in an arena like the AIS arena, and you're on the size of a basketball court. There's generally 11 to 12 judges, depending on the event, depending on the size of the competition, but there's normally an odd number of judges who will stand around with their clipboards. They're generally ex-champions, ex-accredited coaches, and you're put on the floor. You dance heats. And so the heats would be in the discipline of ballroom dancing or Latin dancing or New Vogue dancing. And you go through heats throughout the day to get to a final of six. And then the final of six is dance, and then there's a champion crowned, if you will. And the age divisions go from junior right up to what we call masters or senior, which is anyone who's above 70. So it covers all ages and demographics and skill levels.
And would couples typically be competing across the different disciplines, or do you really specialize in one?
You specialize, it's best to specialize later when you get up the ranks. So you start, there's five levels and everyone starts at number one, and then you work your way up to open grade. And when you get to open grade, that's when it's best to specialize. But in the beginning, you want to start doing all three so you become an adept dancer.
And so you and Alison, what's your go-to, your absolute winning kind of dance?
Oh, Well, see, that's the hard thing. We love them both. We never chose to specialize in one or the other. We did what we call 10 dance, which is where you compete over ballroom and Latin. It's twice the work, but also, I think, twice the fun. But we can't get away from loving a good foxtrot and a rumba as well. They're two beautiful dances.
How would you describe, for people whose only experience with ballroom dancing is maybe some of those celebrity shows or whatever, how would you describe the fundamental difference between ballroom and Latin?
Well, if we look at, okay, so they're two different worlds in their own sense as well. So ballroom dancing originated in England, so it's a little bit more technically driven. They're both technical, but in the sense of you never break hold. Like, you're always dancing as one. And I remember a ballet coach of ours said that, you know, they admired ballroom dancing because they thought it took twice as long to become good at it, because it took two of you to be as good. With Latin, it's a different discipline altogether. It's more rhythmical. If you're doing cha-cha, that's a Cuban dance. If you do samba, that's a Brazilian-inspired dance. So they're two different rhythms. Your body has to be a lot more flexible. It has to be a lot more in tune and totally different training in that sense, but both require basic fundamentals, which you learn at any social studio when you first start.
Does that fundamental, albeit the fundamentals themselves the same, but those differences in the way that you're expressing yourself in those dances,
definitely,
does that make it difficult to switch back and forth between the two, particularly in competition?
Oh yeah, but that's why you start off at the very beginning, right? Because I remember doing the waltz, like, I just got a bare handle on it, and then it's like, and now we're going to do the foxtrot. I'm like, my mouth would drop and be like, oh man, here we go, here's that dance, you know? And it's so you, as your skill set improves, then you can do more. But yes, each dance actually has their own, I suppose, pluses and minuses in their own difficulty.
We are talking to Vaughan Liddicoat this afternoon on ABC Radio Canberra, and we are talking dance sport, ballroom dancing, for our secret sport of Canberra this week. As you mentioned, Vaughan, you and Alison, top 20 in the world, taking you overseas, particularly to England. How did that work? How did you manage to dance your way into those upper echelons?
Well, the classic recipe of persistence and an overwhelming desire to want to train. And you do 5-6 days a week, very little social life. That becomes your social life because you train and then you go compete on a weekend. And in Canberra, there's only one competition a year, or there was. And so we'd go to Sydney to do the competitions and you would just fervently train and dance. That was the recipe: persistence, passion, and a whole lot of really wanting to get better. That really is the mix.
And so every weekend you'd be competing, heading up to Sydney?
About 20 competitions a year.
It sounds exhausting. What was your training regime? Or what is your training regime when you're competing like that?
So every day. You must train every day. Meaning you wouldn't train on a Sunday, but you would at least do something. Your life revolves around it. When you move from, say, the hobby world to the amateur world and then wanting to get to the professional, it becomes like anyone who maybe is a runner or a cyclist. When they go buy the gear, then they start really riding every day, and then they look at their lifestyle. Do they drink too much of their food? You start to take on that athletic mindset and really wanting to do everything you can to get that edge, and then it becomes your life in that way. And then it's very hard to distinguish between dancing and life. It just becomes who you are.
Is it hard to make the leap from amateur dance into the professional ranks?
Definitely not. I think this is the biggest misconception about dancing that I've come across all the time. It's absolutely about belief in your own self, if you can do it, or your coach's belief in you if you don't think you can. And that was me. I was 18, so that's like the dinosaur age in dancing, right? Most people are like, you must have been born dancing. I was like, well, I've always liked dancing, but not training to dance. 18 years old is very hard to, on a back foot, to go into that world in, because most people are champions at 18, 19, 20, and then they continue that. So we already had that back foot sort of launch pad. But like anything, if you really stick to it and you get the right training, right people around you and the right coaches, it's possible.
So what for you guys was the real, was there a moment, a particular competition, a particular title where you looked at each other and went, we're really doing this. This is actually happening.
Yeah, actually it was our first Blackpool competition. And Blackpool is the pinnacle competition. This is the one that, so they need to make a movie on this, right? So Baz did great with Strictly. Blackpool would be the one to go to, because again, with that world of the TV world, it's glamorized. It's a very different thing. When you look at the dance sport world, if you Google on YouTube, you'll see the distinct difference in the way dancing is actually done. But when you look at Blackpool, this is what everyone wants to win. It is the number one oldest, most prestigious championship in the world. It's over 100 years running and everyone wants to win it, right? So you get 400 competitors just in one event. And then it's whittled down to a final of six. And they're all world class. This is not for amateurs, right? It's the top level. And so you go to that competition. The first time we went there, we felt so underqualified. And we were like looking around going, we have to get on this floor? Oh my Lord. And so we just did it anyway and went, we're actually here. And that set the milestone to be like, we've got to go. We've got to come to London and live here. This is where you need to be.
Was that a hard shift to make? I mean, we hear it, well, particularly here at Secret Sports, we find, we come across, we speak to a lot of sports people who, when they're competing in sports that are not on the back pages of the newspaper, they often have to supplement their income with other jobs. They have to work really hard in order to pay for these kind of trips overseas. Was that your experience, or were you able to just dive into the professional world?
Look, I had hit the parent lottery and they support us where they could, but it wasn't like we were self-funded by other outside sources. Mm. It was definitely the figure out a way to make it happen mentality. 7 days a week I was working in real estate. I chose to do that vehicle so I could have flexibility, but it was 7 days a week there, then in the studio of every evening training, and was just do whatever you could. Alison worked as a dental assistant and she did it 3 days a week there, and that was enough to get us moving. And then we just packed everything up, quit the jobs, sold. And we make the joke that if you ever go over to do that sort of thing, like a musician or an artist, or you really want to be in that world, all your money, you'll have $5,000 dresses, but you'll have like potatoes for breakfast, for dinner, right? Like, and you'll split a chicken breast and that's what you eat, and you live in the smallest attic, but all you care about is your dancing. That's what you do. And so you've got everything that looks great. And then outside of that, you know, doesn't matter.
Describe for us how it paid off, making that big move and that leap in terms of your competitive career and what you were able to achieve together.
That opened, that's such a wonderful thing to think about, because it opened up the door. When you work with the masters in a field, so our coaches were not just good dancers. One of them was part of the foundations that actually wrote the ballroom technique back in the 50s. He's still kicking around, right? Another one wrote the Latin technique, right, and put that together. The other two were ex-world championships who are the current leaders in the way it's moving. Penny, she was the same. So all these coaches, they are the masters of it. And when you're around that and you're immersed in it, and we're there for a couple of years, you just cannot help but get better. And that's what it really takes. Everyone who is the best of the best, the top of the world, would be in London training, or they'd be somewhere else, but they'd always come back for lessons, right? You would fly over there for 2 weeks of lessons and then come back. That's the commitment you want.
That's incredible, yeah. I have to say. Yeah. This also reminds me of, and forgive me, but another Strictly Ballroom element which I've always wondered about. So the story turns around many things, but especially the character Scott's desire to dance his own steps at the Pan Pacifics. Is that contentious? Are you allowed to dance whatever steps you want at these kind of competitions, or is it quite prescriptive?
Well, it is very much based upon the technique of dance. Like all art forms change and adapt and move, but there is a foundation. So like, the way you would paint a canvas, you would paint using a paintbrush. Maybe you can use other things, but effectively you're putting paint onto the canvas and that's painting, right? Mm. However many brush strokes you invent. So dancing is very similar. It is moving and evolving, but the base technique changes. But you couldn't exactly do hip hop dancing. You couldn't go and start doing head spins. It's not like that. There's a grounding in the principles you're being also judged on, but it's also how you interpret that. And dancing is that. Dancing is music made visible. So when you've got the technique, you can start to play with it. You can start to play with the steps that are sort of prescribed and give your own flavor and flair to them. And as you get better and better, you start to make them look much different compared to what you might learn when you first start.
Mm. Speaking of when you first start, what is the community like here in the ACT? Yeah.
So it's actually, it's like the underground club, right? Like, so it's there. There's a lot of social dancing that happens. There's events around Canberra where they'll get 100 people going out for a social dance. It's not just an old market, though. A lot of people think you need the gray hair to do the ballroom dancing, right? It's not true at all. There's lots of young kids. I think it's great for adults, but I think they don't realize it's around that much anymore. So we're doing our best to market and to tell people, but it's available. Like, we're also about to do classes starting out in the same-sex community, right? We're going to run classes specifically for that because they want to dance more. They want to come out and enjoy dancing, and there's just no one doing that. And so then there's people that come to meet other people and they get married. And it's like, wow, no, that's not a promise, but it seems to happen quite a lot. You meet some life partners, you know? So it's quite a budgeting area, and it's just a wonderful hobby because anyone can do it in terms of dancing. Like, there's two left feet, like the cure is there. But it's more the enjoyment of it that you dance for rather than trying to be a world champion. If you want to do that, the pathway is there, but you don't start out like that. No one really does that because you're just trying to think, how do I move to this music and not look bad?
Mm. Is it quite a tight-knit community, particularly amongst the people who are on the competition circuit as well? Yes. Or is it, I mean, obviously there's a rivalry there too, but is it also a sort of a camaraderie?
Yes, there's both. When you're on the competition floor, there's always that, you know, everyone's out there to hit the best result they can. And they're, you know, so then in a sense, there's no friends on the floor maybe in that moment, but afterwards you go out for a beer. There's definitely that aspect to it for sure.
So if people are listening to this and they think, maybe this is the time for me to give this a crack, are there open days? Are there opportunities for people to come in and have a try?
Absolutely, yeah. We run classes every week, and so they can come and check us out at the International Dance Studio. And we're more than welcome to we've had people who are blind and deaf come in for classes. We don't discriminate, unless you got a bad attitude. But we love people who want to come and learn, because that's, look, if I can do it, they can definitely do it. There's no difference, just a lot more commitment if you want to be as good as you want to be. But it's such a fun and enjoyable thing for people to do. And like I said, a creative outlet is just so needed with all the stresses in today's world.
I have to say, it's an absolute delight to talk to you about it this afternoon, Vaughan. Your enthusiasm is infectious.
Thank you.
And I'm feeling inspired to go and, I don't know, tap my feet to
you
something.
You definitely
this
can do it, I can
well.
Assure you.
I appreciate it. Thank you so much for coming in this
Thank
afternoon.
Thank you very much.
That's Vaughan Liddicoat. He is the principal at the International Dance Studio with his wife, Alison Liddicoat, four-time Australian professional representatives. Talking dance sport and ballroom dancing for our secret sport of Canberra this afternoon on ABC Radio Canberra. Coming up to 2:30, let's check in with Andrew Messenger and some news headlines.
Thanks, Anna. The Treasury Secretary, John...